Well, good evening. We're going to explore death and dying, hell and heaven, what happens when you die. And I have to tell you candidly, of all the messages that we've prepared over the last several decades, this is really the toughest for many reasons. It's a difficult topic. It's one that you can never completely get your arms around. It's one that is just plagued with myths and superstitions and met with trite cliches, what some people call Bible babble and so on. But we're going to try to get into this because it's unquestionably the most important topic we've ever addressed. And we're going to divide it in two parts. Our present reality first, and the mystery of our destiny, what really happens when we die. One of the things that we're going to try to do is start with our conceptions, or I might even say misconceptions, about where we are today, our present physical reality. Because people ask me, is hell real? Part of that is determined by what you mean by real. And so there are key questions we'll try to address. What happens when you die? When you pass through that portal, what's the first thing you run into? Is there really an afterlife? Many people would deny that. And if so, what's heaven like? And perhaps even more disturbing, is there really a hell? We use that phrase so casually. We know all the superstitions and myths and literary conceptions, but is there really a reality that we call hell? To do this, though, to attack this problem, we have to really understand some other concepts that we also band about pretty casually. The nature of eternity. We use that term. What does it really mean? And this reality that we find ourselves in, this physical world that we think we understand and yet discover we really don't. Although the lifestyles and values and self-perceptions of most adults have undergone significant changes, and millions have embraced the postmodern worldview, it's interesting that the majority of adults continues to believe that there is life after death, that everyone has a soul, and that heaven and hell probably do exist. This may come as a surprise. That despite these traditional views that are surprisingly widely held, over 50 million Americans are uncertain about their personal fate. In terms of a belief in afterlife, 8 out of 10, according to recent research, as recently as September of 2003, 8 out of 10 believe in an afterlife of some sort. And a large majority agree that every person has a soul that will live forever, either in God's presence or absence. An afterlife of some sort. About 9% suggest that an afterlife may exist, but they're not certain. And 1 out of every 10 adults contend that there's no form of life after one dies on Earth. So that's the breakdown. Rather surprising in some respects. 76% of the people canvassed believe that heaven exists. 46% would describe it as a state of eternal existence in God's presence. About 30% think of it as an actual place of rest and reward where souls go after death. There's about 14% that think it's just symbolic, about 5% that doesn't think there really is any such thing, and there's about 5% that feel they're just not sure. But again, it's a surprising percentage. Now you get to the other side of it, about the same proportion of people, 71% versus the 76% in heaven, believe that there's a hell. But there's no real dominant view. About 4 out of 10 adults believe that hell is just a state of eternal separation from God's presence. And about 32%, say 1 in 3, feel it's an actual place of torment and suffering where people's souls go after death. About 13% just regard it as a symbol of some kind of bad outcome. And about 16% are not sure, really don't have a belief or don't believe in it at all. Interesting breakdown. In terms of anticipating a destination, nearly 2/3 of Americans believe that they will go to heaven. 1 in 4 admitted that they probably have no idea what happened after they die. Call it 24%. Less than half of 1% expect to go to hell. 5% feel they just cease to exist at death, about 1 in 20. And about 5% believe that they're coming back in another life form. This view of this concept of reincarnation that pervades so much Eastern mysticism and the rest. And that obviously is not a biblical concept, but whenever I run into this issue of reincarnation, around Halloween or whenever, I'm indebted to Gail Irwin, who called to my attention a poem that I can't resist inserting in this presentation. It's a poem by Walt McCrae. What is reincarnation? A cowboy asked his friend. It starts, his old pal told him, when your life comes to an end. They comb your hair, they wash your neck, they clean your fingernails, and they put you in a padded box away from life's travails. Now the box in you goes into the hole that's been dug into the ground. Reincarnation starts in when you're planted beneath that mound. Them clods melt down just like the box and you who is inside. And that's when you begin your transformation ride. And in a while, the grass will grow upon your rendered mound, till someday upon that spot, a lonely flower is found. Then a horse may wander by and graze upon that flower that once was you and now has become your vegetated bower. Now the flower the horse done eat along with his other feed makes bone and fat and muscle essential to the steed. But there's a part that he can't use, so it just passes through. And there it lies upon the ground, this thing that once was you. And if perchance I should pass by and see this on the ground, I'll stop a while and ponder at this object that I found. And I'll think about reincarnation and life and death and such. But I'll come away concluding, why, you ain't changed all that much. Okay, at the chagrin of my staff, I had to include that just for a light thing. I got that from Gail Irwin at a men's conference, who apparently tracked it down. It's Wallace McCrae did a series of cowboy poems. That's one of them. But getting more serious about it, there are people that really take reincarnation seriously, and it's not a biblical concept. But of this whole survey, it's interesting that less than 1%, about half of 1% of people feel that they may indeed enter hell. It's obviously not not surprising, yet it's tragic, especially since Jesus Christ spoke more about hell than he did heaven. And the Creator himself entered our creation, became a man, to deliver us from that terrifying jeopardy that we all face. Now, of those that believe they're heaven-bound, it's interesting, too, that they feel they're going heaven-bound because 43% felt they're going to heaven because they confessed their sins and accepted Christ as their Savior. Fair enough. About 15% feel they've tried to obey the Ten Commandments. Whoops. And 15% feel they're going to heaven because they're basically a good person. That's a widespread assumption. 6% believe they're going to heaven because God loves all people and will not let them perish. So it's interesting, about 43% have a biblical view, and the others, of course, have some confusion on this whole topic. What's interesting about the research, this is all Barna Research Group in Ventura, California, pulled this together. A lot of the findings are quite self-contradictory. Among born-again Christians, 10% believe that people are reincarnated after death. Isn't that confusing? 29% claim it's possible to communicate with the dead, even though necromancy, of course, is strongly forbidden in the Bible. 50% contend that a person can earn their salvation based on good works. There again, they haven't done their homework. And many believe that there are multiple options for gaining entry into heaven. So these contradictions prevail throughout the survey. Many have redefined grace to mean that God is so eager to save people from hell that he will change his nature and universal principles for their own individual benefit. That's basically what they are assuming. And it's interesting that not only Christians are confused, obviously atheists and agnostics are also confused. 50% admit in the questions that every person has a soul, heaven and hell exist, and there is life after death. That's a strange view to emerge out of those that would be normally defined as atheists and agnostics. 12% admit that believing and accepting Jesus Christ probably makes life after death possible. And so the labels obviously are not descriptive. And obviously many people who identify themselves in one way are really, they evidence the adoption of very simplistic views from novels and entertainment, movies, that sort of thing. Very superficial. You know, that's really tragic because, you know, if you and I were traveling to a foreign country, our desk would be littered with brochures and background on those countries, especially if we were not just visiting, but say moving there on a career change for a period of time. We would really study that destination, know a lot about it. Well, all of us are going to cross a threshold into a whole nother adventure, and we haven't, in general, taken the trouble to investigate what we really know about what's coming. So one of the things that we're going to try to do, first of all, we're going to try to shed the baggage of our misconceptions and presumptions on this topic. We're going to explore a little bit about the role of the creation and our conceptions of reality that underlie this whole discussion. We'll talk about the fact we now know, the great discovery of 20th century science is that our universe is finite, it's not infinite. We're going to talk a little bit about the nature of time because that undergirds any concept of philosophy, any concept of eternity, all these things suffer from our misconceptions about the nature of time itself. We're going to talk a little bit about the nature of our, what we call reality. What do we mean by hyperspaces? We'll talk a little bit about the insights we get from the paradoxes of quantum physics. And much of this material may be familiar to some of our regulars because we, of course, have adopted much of this material in our Learn the Bible in 24 Hours products and some of our other briefings. But we wanted this message to stand on its own, so I'm going to indulge in a little review of some of these fundamental things that undergird our studies here. But let's talk a little bit about avoiding truth. You know, there is a principle which is a bar against all information, which is proof against all argument, and which cannot fail to keep man in everlasting ignorance. That principle is condemnation before investigation. Edmund Spencer is famous for that particular quote. You'll find the equivalent in the Bible in Proverbs 18:13. He that answereth a matter before he heareth it, it is a folly and a shame unto him. So what I'm going to ask you to do is try to set aside the presumptions and presuppositions that we have on these topics, because we all have them. Let's try to set those aside and try to explore this difficult subject with an open mind. So we'll do it in two parts. This first part is our present reality, and we'll do a second session following this called The Mystery of Our Destiny. But let's get some background on our present reality in front of us first. Before we start any further, though, I want to underscore the whole approach of our ministry. It's based on, obviously, a biblical position. And biblical skepticism has been popular in the past because of doubts about the historicity of the patriarchal accounts, about the denial of even having writing in Moses' day, and the Gospels and Epistles being the second century after the fact, and so forth. The good news is most of these have been debunked. It's now refuted by archaeological discoveries, documentary discoveries, and competent analysis. So you and I can take the position that most people who hold these peculiar skeptical views are simply uninformed in terms of modern discoveries. Our ministry is based on two primary discoveries. The first is that we have 66 books that we glibly call the Bible, even though they were penned by over 40 different guys over virtually 2,000 years. It's an integrated message, and not simply thematically. Every number, every place name, every detail is there by skillful engineering. And once you discover that for yourself, it opens up a whole different perspective of what we call the Word of God. And the second discovery derives from that. If it's an integrated message, even though we have 66 separate books, 40 different guys over thousands of years that penned it, its origin, we can demonstrate, had to come from outside our dimensionality of time. And once you discover that for yourself, it'll change your whole perspective of the Bible, and it certainly is essential for the topics that we're going to be exploring in this session. So let's start a little bit with exploring this whole peculiar thing we call time. And there's an atomic clock located at the National Institute of Standards and Technology in Boulder, Colorado, and there's an identical clock, atomic clock, located at Greenwich, at the Royal Observatory in Greenwich, England. Now these clocks are accurate to better than 1 second per million years. And I'm always reminded at the time when I was on the board of a company that was acquiring a frequency time system company in Boston. And the president came to our board meeting, very proud of the product, which is primarily these cesium clocks that are accurate to better than a second in a million years. And I raised my hand as a director of the acquiring company, saying, I only have two questions. How do you know? and who cares, you know? Well, the way you know is from the resonant, the properties of the cesium atom, frankly, but the who cares? It turns out that your accuracy of time measurement determines the precision of your navigation. And these devices, of course, are the things that make the global positioning satellite system so accurate and so useful. So, it's interesting that these clocks are that precise. Now, one of the questions, see the natural, it's all based on the natural resonance of the cesium atom. That's what gives them the precision here. But the point is, these clocks, one in Greenwich, England, one in Boulder, are accurate to better than 1 second every million years. And yet, the one at Boulder ticks, in effect, 5 millionths of a second every year faster than the identical clock at Greenwich. Which one's correct? Not a big deal, but measurable and predictable. Turns out they're both correct. And the one at Boulder is at 5,400 feet altitude, and the one at Greenwich, England, is at 80 feet above sea level. And so the difference in altitude makes the gravity slightly different, and that's part of the discovery. That's part of what I'm trying to get across. We know today that time is a physical property. If I had an atomic clock here on the platform and I raised it 1 meter, it would speed up by one part in 10 to the 16th. Not a big deal, but it is predictable and it is measurable. And so, not enough to change your schedules, but profoundly significant understanding the nature of time. Let me give you some other examples. They actually put atomic clocks on an aircraft going around the world eastward, and it lost about 59 nanoseconds. And they put one on a clock going around westward, and compared to one at stationary at the observatory, it gained 273 nanoseconds. Not a big deal, but it was predictable and measured, and it confirmed Einstein's general theory of relativity. Now, if you read up about this in, say, a physics textbook, they'll usually talk about two hypothetical astronauts. These guys, theoretically, board at the same instant. One we're going to leave here, and one we're going to send to the nearest star. Now, if you go to the night sky, our closest star is Alpha Centauri. It's about 4.5 light years away. And in our imaginary experiment here, we're going to send one of these twin brothers to that star, at, say, at half the speed of light, and back. Well, if it's 4.5 light years away and we're going to send them at half the speed of light, it'll take them 9 years to get there and 9 years back on our clock. That's on the Earth, by Earth time. On the clock that he's carrying with him, that's a different thing altogether. And there is some, I won't go through the math, the Lorentz transformations apply here, and as you apply those, it turns out that on his clock, the 18 years, the 9 years there and 9 years back, will take place in 15 years and 7 months. He will return to the Earth 2 years and 5 months younger than his twin brother. And if that doesn't bother you, you weren't listening carefully. See, his time will be different than the time we have due to the fact the accelerations and so forth and the velocities involved here. So the main point here, and to dramatize this just a little bit further, let's imagine that we could send him almost at the speed of light. Let's assume we send him at 99.99% of the speed of light. So let's assume we could do that. Then it would be 9 years round trip, 4.5 there, 4.5 back, on his clock. Excuse me, on our clock here on the Earth. But on his clock, it would be 33 days. So certainly the first thing he wants to do is invest carefully in his stock portfolio before leaving. But in any case, Einstein created a revolution, starting with a special theory of relativity in 1905, in which mass, velocity, and so forth was relative to the observer. But the more important one was his general theory of relativity in 1915. And why that's important to you and me is because he recognized that you and I don't live in just three dimensions. He recognized that there's a fourth dimension, that Planck's constant is really a four-dimensional constant. He recognized that there's no distinction between time and space. You and I live in a four-dimensional, or more, continuum. And this is no longer a theory. It's been confirmed in 14 different ways to 19 decimal places. So the general theory of relativity is a very, very fundamental insight. But the reason it's important for you and I is we need to understand that time is a physical property. It's not uniform. It varies with mass, acceleration, or gravity, among other things. Now, you and I live in more than four dimensions, actually. Actually, we know now that we probably live in about 10. But I'll come back to that. See, the reason we have some misconceptions, when we were in school, the teacher would go to the blackboard and draw a line from left to right. And the left end would be the beginning of something, the birth of a famous person or the founding of an empire. The right end of that line would be the end of the death of that person or the falling of that empire. And all of us have made timelines in school. So when we encounter the concept of eternity, we tend to presume it's sort of like a line. It starts at infinity on the left and goes to infinity on the right. We think of eternity as simply having lots of time, an unlimited amount of time. And that makes colorful poetry. It's one of our verses in our hymns, "An Amazing Grace," tends to presume that in effect. But let's ask ourselves a few questions. Let's talk about God. Is God subject to the restrictions of mass, acceleration, or gravity? Hardly. So God is not somebody who has lots of time. He is one who is outside the restrictions of time altogether. And that's exactly what Isaiah tells us, that thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity. Now, if he has the technology to create us in the first place, he has the technology to get a message to us. The question is, how does he authenticate his message? How does he let us know the message we receive is really from him and not some kind of contrivance or some kind of a fraud? One way he authenticates it is to rely on an attribute that's unique to him, that he's outside the dimensionality of time. And so that's exactly what Isaiah tells us in Isaiah 46, verse 10, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done. God authenticates his message, among other things, by writing history before it happens, demonstrating that the origin is from outside time. So let's talk a little bit what I'll call the geometry of eternity. I've used a line horizontally in two dimensions here, but imagine this line that I'm showing on the screen is coming out at you in a third dimension. And behind, in the back part of the line is the past. Where we are, we'll call it the present, and what's ahead of us is the future. For us, life and time is a sequence of events from the past through the present to the future. But for someone who's outside the dimensionality of that timeline, say in what we call eternity, from that vantage point, they can see the past, the present, and the future simultaneously. We can't imagine that because we are limited in our thinking to the dimensionality that we're constrained to. But someone that is outside the dimensionality, that's no problem. Let me give you something you might be able to visualize. Imagine you're sitting on a curb watching a parade. Around the corner comes the marching units, the bands, the troops, whatever. And as they come by, for you, the parade is a sequence of events. They come around this corner, they go down the street, they go out and out that way. For someone who's outside the plane of that existence, say in a helicopter above the parade, they can see the staging area where the units are forming up. They can watch the parade as it, you know, snakes through the city that it's going in, and they can also see where it's disbanded, going back to storage or whatever. So they can see simultaneously the beginning, what's happening, and the end from their vantage point. It's perhaps a clumsy analogy, but it gets across the idea that another dimension adds all kinds of capabilities. You know, Albert Einstein, my favorite quote of Dr. Einstein is that people like us, he says, who believe in physics, know that the distinction between the past, the present, and the future is only a stubbornly persistent illusion. So he recognized that time is a uniqueness to our particular predicament in the reality that we find ourselves. So I want to talk a little bit more about the fabric of our universe. We take this also for granted. We know that the universe is not infinite. Why? Well, for lots of reasons. We know from thermodynamics, heat always flows from hot bodies to cold bodies. If the universe was infinitely old, it would be at a uniform temperature. It's not. It's still cooling down. So it had a beginning, and it'll have an end. That's provable thermodynamically. So it's not infinitely old. It had a beginning, and also it's destined for an ending. And we know that just from the laws of science. But another concept that has shattered most classical physicists is the discovery that the speed of light is not a constant. That's been a dictum of the physics world for many, many years. Back in the 17th century, Kepler, René Descartes, and others all believed that light was instantaneous, or putting another way, had an infinite speed. That was the common presumption. But in 1677, a Dutchman by the name of Olaf Romer, by measuring the eclipses of one of Jupiter's satellites, when it's far away in its orbit and when it's closer, could compare that and get a measure of the speed of light. And he figured that out, and he discovered that the speed of light was finite, roughly about 300,000 kilometers per second. The physics world never accepted that. For over 50 years, they clung to the presumption that it was infinite, until an Englishman, James Bradley, in 1729, confirmed Romer's work. And that's when they began to reluctantly recognize the speed of light was measurable and finite. In over 300 years, the speed of light has been measured 164 times by 16 different methods. And up until a few years ago, we took a lot of abuse from some of our friends in classical physics because we recognized the work of Barry Sutterfield and Trevor Norman, who had been suggesting the speed of light's not a constant. And the Sutterfield and Norman, over the last 15 years, they started to compare all the experiments that have been done through the years on measuring the speed of light, and they discovered some interesting things. Romer's original data suggested the speed of light was 307,600,000 kilometers per second with a range of plus or minus 5,400 kilometers per second. Not bad for the 17th century technology. In 1875, Harvard repeated the same thing, got a slightly different number, 299,921. The range of error was way down, now from not from 5,400 kilometers, but down to 13 kilometers, because technology is improving through the time. We get to 1983, the National Bureau of Standards, using a laser, again measured the speed of light, and by now, the technology is such that the range of error is very, very small. But what's bizarre is look at the means. Romer's mean was 307,000 kilometers per second. Harvard was less, 299. National Bureau of Standards, again, slightly. What's interesting, and these are just three data points, there's actually hundreds, but they all show the mean getting smaller through the speed slowing down through time. The idea that the speed of light is not a constant shatters the conception of most classical physics, because that affects atomic behavior, it goes through our whole physical universe. But up until about 2 years ago, this was highly controversial. When we published articles in our news journal, we got a lot of chuckles from some people. In the last 2 years, there have been increasing articles in the reputable scientific journals recognizing the speed of light's not a constant. And in 1967, they changed the definition of a second, by the way. Previously, it was defined in terms of an orbit around the sun, and at that time, they changed it to atomic time. But that's why, from that day on, it's kind of you have to be more clever as to how you measure these things. But it turns out that atomic clocks and the orbital movements are no longer in sync. If the atomic clocks are correct, then the orbital speeds of Mercury, Venus, and Mars are increasing, which is impossible to take energy. See, if the gravitational constant is truly constant, then the atomic vibrations and the speed of light have been decreasing. And that's the discovery that Tom Van Flanderen at the U.S. Naval Observatory has been publishing for some time, and it's creating, there's a whole stir in the whole field of physics. The orbital clocks, if they're favored, then the planet's orbital speed is increased, it would violate the law of conservation of energy. If the atomic clocks are correct, that implies that the gravitational constant should change. Of course, it hasn't. So, now there's another thing going on that also is shattering our concept of reality. And that's this whole issue of the red shift. Most of you that know anything about astronomy are familiar with the fact that stars have their spectrum slightly shifted to the red. They call it the red shift. Edwin Hubble, back in the 20s, postulated that that shift is due to the fact that these stars are moving away from us. So the whole concept of the expanding universe hangs on the fact of this red shift. The further away the star is, the more it seems to shift to the red. Well, that all sounds pretty good, except there's a couple of guys over the last couple of decades, Halton Arp in Germany and William Tift in the University of Arizona, have been collecting information, carefully collecting red shift information, and they discover some bizarre things, not the least of which is that the shift, the red, is always in a digital step. That is, there's a number, it's always a multiple of. It's not variable, it's a multiple of a number. In other words, quantized. And that shatters any attempt to explain why it shifted to the red. It can't be a Doppler effect. It can't be the expansion thing. This quantization of the red shift data may be evidence, strange enough, that there's a basic change going on in the property of space itself. It's an atomic effect rather than a recessional velocity effect. Now, the curve that's implied by all this, Alan Montgomery in Canada, statistician, carefully has analyzed this and gets a 95% correlation with a cosecant squared curve, which says, in effect, that backtracking from what we know today, the speed of light apparently was about 10 to 30% faster in the time of Christ, about twice as fast in the days of Solomon, about four times as fast in the days of Abraham, and maybe as much as 10 million times as fast prior to 3000 BC. And so this is beginning to shatter our concepts of this thing we call reality and the age of our universe, etc. But for our purposes, we just want to have some caution here about the presumptions we make about the universe, because the whole field of physics and cosmology and astrophysics has got the rug pulled out from under it. It's interesting. Let's talk about this business of stretching the heavens. That's the expression you see all through the scripture. Let's talk about the fabric of space. Is this just a metaphor? In Job 9:8, it speaks of God who alone stretches out the heavens. In Psalm 104, stretching out the heaven like a tent curtain. Who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent to dwell in, Isaiah 40. He has stretched out the heavens, Jeremiah 10. Notice how all through the scripture you find this strange expression about space, the Lord who stretches out the heavens, in Zechariah 12. In fact, there are 17 passages that use this very directly, and others that even infer it in other ways, more indirectly. Space, we know today, is not an empty vacuum. You and I tend to imagine that space out there between the stars, whatever, is empty, that it's an empty vacuum. We speak of the empty vacuum of space. Well, the Bible says it can be torn, Isaiah 64. It can be worn out like a garment, according to Psalm 102. It can be shaken, according to Hebrews 12, Haggai 2, and Isaiah 13. It can be burnt up, Peter warns us in 2 Peter 3. It can be split apart like a scroll, according to Revelation 6. It can be rolled up like a mantle or a scroll in Hebrews 1 and Isaiah 34. Now today we know that space has properties. We know today that if you take a cubic centimeter of empty vacuum of space, cool it down to absolute zero, they call that the zero point, it still retains as much energy as 100 million suns. That there's a residual energy there. In fact, that energy seems to explain why electrons don't spiral into the nucleus, that it's sustained by that energy base. We know that property space has a dielectric constant, a permittivity, if you will, a permeability, that's a magnetic constant. It has an intrinsic impedance. Every radio ham who's tuned to an antenna knows that the impedance of space is about 377 ohms. In other words, it has physical properties. And the velocity of light at creation was probably 2 to the 10th times its present velocity, which is probably the present speed of gravity. But the point is, space has properties. You and I don't think of it that way. And now, space can be rolled up, according to the Bible. So if it can be rolled up, there must be some additional dimension that can be rolled up. And if I have a two-dimensional piece of paper, to roll it up into a scroll takes a third dimension. To be able to roll it up requires an additional dimension that's more than just intrinsic. See, there must be some dimension which it can be thin. There must be some dimension into which it can be bent, you see. And so in order to be bent toward and so forth. So these are hints already in the scripture that there are additional dimensions to the dimensions we think of. We think of three dimensions because we're used to a three-dimensional space. But we know from the scripture and now from quantum physics that space has more than three dimensions. So we're moving suddenly into this area of hyperdimensions. You say, what's this got to do with the subject? You'll see. Because I think this whole area of what we're talking about is our portal from leaving this temporary reality that we find ourselves in. We're going to go into hyperdimensions. Now, most of us have been trained, whether we realize it or not, in what's called Euclidean geometry. And we're going to go beyond Euclid. To be anything with more than three dimensions is called a hyperdimension. The most important lecture in mathematics was given on June 10th of 1854 by George Riemann when he developed a thing called metric tensors. And it took 60 years for Einstein to take that mathematics and develop his theory of relativity. Einstein went to his death frustrated because he couldn't reconcile the next step. If he'd gone to five or six dimensions, he went to four and solved his problem. If he'd gone to five or six, he would have resolved those things that frustrated him to his death. Now, the current thinking, of course, is that you and I live in not four, not five, six, but in 10 dimensions. And Einstein developed his theory of relativity, which basically recognized a four-dimensional space-time. In 53, Kaluza and Klein conspired to develop more than four dimensions to reconcile light and supergravity. And then Yang Mills in 63 developed the electromagnetic and were able to reconcile both nuclear forces. In 1984 and following, the current thinking in physics is what they call superstrings, one-dimensional strings that vibrate in 10 dimensions. Now, to you and I, that doesn't make much sense, but I'll tell you what's interesting, is that if you go back and study the writings of Nachmanides, he's one of the two most venerated Hebrew sages of the 12th century, and or actually 13th century. He concluded by studying Genesis chapter 1 that we live in 10 dimensions. Four of them are directly knowable and six are not, according to his theory. He published this in his commentary on Genesis. And I find this fascinating because you and I live in a culture where we spent millions of dollars building atomic accelerators to discover that we live in 10 dimensions. Four are directly measurable, three spatial plus time, and the six are not directly accessible because they're smaller than the wavelength of light. So they're only inferable by indirect means, but well confirmed, it seems. Now, as we go into the scripture, I have to share this with you. In Ephesians chapter 3, Paul writes, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Most of us read that in Ephesians chapter 3. We may miss something subtle here. You notice what he said? Paul says the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height. How many are there? Four dimensions. And one of the word, the Greek word for length is a measurement of time, by the way. So I think that's fascinating. Did Paul really know we live in a four-dimensional space? Or is this just the Holy Spirit editing in his style? Don't know. But we really have encountered the boundaries of reality. There are two concepts that you and I talk about in mathematics that are not available in the physical world. They're elusive. The first is randomness. We talk about randomness. We talk about chance. But in modern science, there's a whole emergent field in mathematics called the theory of chaos, because they've discovered most of us have been trained in mathematics in what's called deterministic mathematics. 2 + 2 = 4. Always. Always. 2 + 2 = 4. Period. End of discussion. That's deterministic. Most engineering equations are deterministic. There's another field of mathematics called stochastic processes or random processes, where the numbers represent distributions. Approximately 2 and approximately 2 is approximately 4. With what range? Depends what the mean and variances are. So you suddenly get into populations. And that there's a whole field of advanced statistics that deal with that are impacted by apparent randomness. But we discover we can't really create randomness. In a computer, you have a random number generator, but if you're a professional, you know it's not a real random number. It's a pseudo-random number. There's a generator that will generate numbers that have all the properties they can manage that they're approximately random, but they're not truly random. And we discover as you get into this, conceptually, they can't create a truly chance event. And they call that theory, that whole area of mathematics, chaos theory. It's a frontier of mathematics. What most people don't realize is the very existence of that theory of mathematics pulls the rug out from under evolution, because there is no such thing as chance. There is no such thing as chance. But this is what the scripture says in the first place. The lot is cast in the lap, but the whole disposing thereof is of the Lord. Einstein said the same thing. One of his famous quotes is, Albert Einstein says, God does not play dice. That was his frustration with quantum physics as it was emerging. God does not play dice. Do you know why? If he did, he'd win. There is no such thing as chance. These things which appear random to us are not. Well, there's another concept that we do not find in the physical universe. That's infinity. In the macrocosm, the universe is not infinite. It has a limit. They've discovered that in the 20th century, the macrocosm. But there's also something even more disturbing, and that's at the microcosm. If I have a line and I cut it in half, you would think that I could take whatever's left and cut it in half. And indeed, I could. And whatever's left there, I could cut it in half again. I could do it again and again and again. Always, whatever I had left, I could cut in half. You would think, instinctively, at least theoretically, that I could do that forever. It turns out, when I get down to 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, if I try to cut that in half, it ceases to have locality. What remains is everywhere at once. It has a property that the physicists called non-locality. Subatomic particles, we know today, have a property called non-locality. And that's disturbing. They've discovered that all photons in the universe know what all the other photons are doing. They're intrinsically connected some way. And these concepts, the more you know about quantum physics, the more disturbing it is. There's a length, there's a Planck length of 10 to the minus 33 centimeters. There's a period of time, 10 to the minus 43 seconds. You can't get a period of time shorter than that. And so we discover that the universe as we know it is a digital simulation. And the implications that are shattering, Boltzmann, one of the great atomic scientists that was at the frontier of quantum physics as it emerged, committed suicide as he realized the implications. He could not reconcile this. We are in a digital simulation. So the reality, the thing we call reality, is actually a virtual reality. We do that with games and stuff, and they're getting more and more sophisticated. There's even some science fiction stories where the people create a virtual world with virtual people and so forth. We can begin to understand what we mean by virtual reality. The reality we're in is a virtual reality, in effect. In fact, David Bohm, who's one of Einstein's associates, when he discovered holography, was thrilled because he suddenly realized here's a model that seems to fit the universe. He thinks he has this view that all the world that we know is what he calls the explicate order. It's unfolded, that it's a tangible, everyday physical reality. But there's an implicate, larger, if you will, order, a more primary, deeper underlying reality that he calls the implicate order. You say, well, he's some kind of fringe guy. No. He has sympathetic report from people like Roger Penrose of Oxford. He's the creator of the modern theory of black holes. Bernard Espignat, which is of the University of Paris. He's one of the leading authorities, the foundations of quantum theory. And Brian Josephson. If you've been in semiconductors, you know what a Josephson junction is. Brian Josephson got the Nobel Prize in 1973 in physics, University of Cambridge. These guys believe that David Bohm is on the right track, that our universe is not only a simulation, it's like a super hologram. But you know, it's interesting, as we look at the scripture, 2 Corinthians 4:18, Paul says, we look not at things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. This is one of thousands of verses we can pick from the Bible, which has always spoken of a broader, more serious, more permanent reality that we call, glibly, the spiritual world. It's the real world. What we are in is a special subset of that that's been established for certain purposes. In Romans chapter 1, Paul writes, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." It's interesting, we could take dozens of verses which point out that God holds all people accountable to know who he is, if no other way, by the creation itself. And so he goes on, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools." And it goes on to describe the results of all of that. Now, you and I live in a culture that is permeated with a mythology of evolution. And I don't mean little adaptations. We're talking about biogenesis, that life just happened. And you know, it's interesting that pervades not just our science textbooks in our schools, it pervades our fields of psychology, fields of law. Our whole culture takes for granted this premise of evolution. And it's strange, we live at a time where evolution is recognized by the leading scientists as no longer a viable explanation. We live in an era that could be called the death of Darwinism. Advances in microbiology, the DNA, all these have dealt a death blow to Darwinism. Why? Because DNA is a digital code, a 3 out of 4 error correcting code. And the implications of that are shattering because there's no way it could have happened by chance. It is very skillfully designed. Darwinism cannot explain the origin of life because it cannot explain the origin of information. And the whole concept of irreducible complexity, which is now understood in design, refutes chance as a designer. And there's a very fundamental insight. Clearly, you and I are the products of design. And if by design, then there must be a designer. And if there's a designer, he has a purpose and an accountability, and we have an accountability. And that's why it's a basic premise of the The present scientific establishment is to search for explanations that deny a designer. They're no longer engaged in a pursuit of truth. They're engaged in a pursuit of explanations that have a mechanistic result. Well, that's a quick survey of the shaky foundations of reality that we call reality. Let's shift now to ourselves. Let's talk a little bit about the architecture of ourselves. Most of us have seen pictures in a doctor's office or in a textbook of our anatomy, our organs and tissues and so forth. That's just what I'll call the hardware environment. You know, in the scripture, we have words for the body, soul, and spirit. And the trifold nature of man pervades the scripture from end to end. And in the Hebrew, in the Old Testament, we have the word nephesh, which is used many ways, but very close to what we would call the soul, and also ruach, which is the spirit. And there are various words for the body, depending which part of the body you're talking about. The word nephesh can mean soul, self. It also can be used for life, creature, person, appetite, mind, living being. It also can allude to desire, emotion, passion. It's translated out of 751 occurrences, 575 times it's translated soul. So it's close to what you and I think of in the English word as soul. There are places where it's used as a figure of speech, meaning life itself. 29 places, there's a number of, it can mean person, mind, heart, creature, body, and so forth. It can be used as a figure of speech, what's called in rhetoric a synecdoche, where you take the specific for the general and the general for the specific. It's like saying the ship went down with 17 souls aboard. Well, we don't mean just the souls, they drown. I mean, we use that term, that's called a synecdoche. We're using that term for the total. Or I'll say, lend me a hand. I don't want just your hand, I'd like your whole body to come help me move this cart or something. See, so these are synecdoches. I don't mean his hand, I'm using the specific to imply the general. And the word nephesh, of course, is used that way too. And it can be used three different ways. The physical life, it's 150 times in the Old Testament, just means a physical life. Adam's body was complete, yet unanimated, until God placed in it the spirit of life in Genesis 2:7. A second way it's used is figurative, as a synecdoche for the whole person. So I just use the example, a ship going down with, 200 nepheshes aboard, souls aboard. But the intent way, the dominant way, is used as what you and I would call the soul, the inner being, that transcendent self that departs at death and returns with life at the resurrection. And that's all in Genesis, all the way through the Old Testament. It's also refers to that which is attributed to reason, emotion, will, worship, those qualities of a person that distinguish them, say, from an animal. And these are just extracts from one of the primary Hebrew lexicons, Brown, Driver, and Briggs. And so, now, in the rabbinic literature, it's clear that nephesh was understood that the soul was to be invisible and immortal. That was the rabbinical concept. Even in Josephus, he points out that all Jews except the Sadducees believed in the immortality of the soul, or the nephesh. And Eusebius, and the doctrine of soul sleep was invented in the 3rd century. But these other ideas came later. There's another term that's a troublesome term in a sense. That's the word ruach, which can mean breath or wind. It's also used for God, God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit. It's occasionally used meaning angels, both good and evil. It's used of life and men. It's sometimes used of disembodied spirits, both good and bad. Disposition or attitude, he has a mean spirit, that sort of thing. And it's also used for the seat of the emotion and the will. So there's an overlap between ruach and nephesh in some usages. And it's translated spirit in the holy or general sense 232 times. It's translated wind 92 times. So it's got two different meanings, but they're in a semantic sense, they're very close. And breath, 27, and it's mentioned some other things, a relatively trivial number of times. The Greek term that's sort of like that is like nephesh, is suki. In the Septuagint, that's the translation from the Old Testament translation into Greek. Suki translates the word nephesh 785 out of 810 cases. So suki is the word from which psychology comes, if you will. And so the psyche and the nephesh are close cousins, if you will. It's interesting that never in the Greek do they use bios, the Greek word for physical life, to be the equivalent of nephesh. So nephesh clearly is that was seen as that which is the soul. Okay. So it deliberately, the translators deliberately avoid equating the soul with mere physical life. This is very important to understand here. And of course, I mentioned that psyche is where the word psychology is derived. So we have in the Greek pneuma, psyche, and soma. Pneuma being the air is one word to get the word pneumatics, psyche and soul. And the word psyche means breath of life, just like ruach does pretty much. It's used for soul 58 times out of 105, life in general 40 times, and a few other uses. The word pneuma is used of the movement of air or wind, it's a breath of nostrils, so forth. It's the word from which we get the word pneumatics, air-driven tools and so forth. But it's also used in the Greek to be the spirit, that vital principle by which the body is animated, the rational spirit, the power by which human being feels and thinks and decides, that is the soul. It also is used as a spirit or some kind of essence, devoid of all matter, but possessing, being sentient, knowing the power of knowing, desiring, and deciding and acting and so forth. It's used of a term, a spirit higher than man but lower than God, like, in other words, angels and so forth. And it's also a term used in a proper name sense of the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit. It's interesting, it's a neuter name on the one hand, but it's used as a person, masculine person in the grammar. So the word pneuma, out of 385 times, is usually a spirit or Holy Ghost or Spirit of Christ or the human spirit, dominant use of it in the biblical text. So we've had the word nephesh in the Hebrew. The word psyche in the Greek is not exactly the same, but very close. And we have ruach and pneuma, pneuma in the Greek and ruach in the Hebrew. Not exactly the same. And what's interesting, some people stumble by picking an example of a verse which is using it as a figure of speech in that area where there is not overlap and try to build doctrine from it. That obviously is not competent exegesis. And of course, the soma is the Greek word for body, and there's several words in the Hebrew that are used. Now, in the English, of course, we have body, soul, and spirit that approximate these terms very closely, but not precisely. Okay? We together? Now, as we look at body, soul, and spirit, we have the tripartite part of man. But I want to change subjects a little bit here because I think this is useful. I found it, as I travel, a very useful insight. And I have up here on the platform a computer. If you knew everything there is to know about every piece of hardware inside that machine, every circuit, every microcircuit, every transistor, every capacitor, every part of that computer, and you knew all there was to know about it, could you tell me anything about its behavior? And the answer, of course, is no, because that is determined by the software. See, if I look at the computer architecture, what I have inside the box, there is somewhere in there a central processing unit. That's the actual electronics that manipulates information according to some kind of language. And there's also some electronics that allow you to communicate with it, what we call input and output, that connects it to a keyboard or a monitor or what have you. The central processing unit has available to it a memory. And it can put things in the memory and pull things out of the memory as it needs it. In the memory, of course, are data, lists of people or whatever. But it also in the memory is what we call the programs, the software. What makes the computer something different than simply a very complex adding machine is that in the memory is a program that the computer can modify. The fact that the computer can modify its own program is what differentiates it from just a super adding machine. There are all kinds of complicated machines built through the years, that like knitting machines and stuff, that would follow a fixed program. That's not what we're talking about. This is what many people call the von Neumann architecture, where the computer has in its memory the program it's following, but there are ways by which that computer can alter that memory. It can learn and do other interesting things. Well, what I want to do is talk a little bit. Most of us wouldn't have any exposure to how is that software organized? Well, let me just take a look. Let's talk briefly about the software architecture. Inside that software thing, the primary thing is a master program, classically called the operating system, that manages the computer for you, because you don't really want to do that for lots of reasons. The operating system includes a user interface where the computer can make itself look to you in such a way that you're comfortable with. For some, it can look like an Apple computer, it can look like a PC, or it can look like a other kind. So the point is there's different, some interfaces are very simple for a naive user, some interfaces are very sophisticated for the more sophisticated. But it can adopt a style, a presentation to you that we call the user interface. So inside the operating system, there's also a super program that manages the memory. You don't really want to, you don't really care where a person's name physically is located. You go by a logical address, the computer's put it someplace conveniently. If you use it a lot, it'll move it to a more convenient place for you. You don't care about that. All you care about is for it, it is more capable at managing the memory than you would be. So it manages that memory, and inside that memory, of course, are not just one, but maybe several application programs that can be running simultaneously. The reason I get into all this, and all of this, by the way, is in, the way you get it, is in machine language. You can use the benefit of all of this, but you can't change it significantly. That's why you can go to a computer store and buy someone's proprietary software and get the benefit of using it, but you can't change it or discover the secrets that are inside it. Why? Because it's all in machine language in the first place, and it's all embedded inside of programs which are embedded inside of programs. It would take an incredible amount of insight to get into the kernel, into the guts of it. You see, you can't tell much about the software by x-raying the computer. You follow me? That's what I'm trying to say. Now you say, Chuck, what's this got to do with us? Well, see, in the first place, the field of, as I look out here and at the audience here, my frustration is that I can't see you. I can see the temporary residences that you're in, because the real you, isn't physical in the first place. You can call it soul or spirit, give it what labels you like, that's vocabulary. The real you is resident inside a temporary hardware environment. I can remember vividly, since I travel a lot, and I also have a pretty tight publishing schedule, I depend heavily on a laptop as I travel. And for several years, I traveled with this one of the early laptops. It finally died. It finally just got from all the abuse of travel. It finally died, and I was in big trouble until some friends of the ministry, recognizing my predicament, treated me as a gift to a top-of-the-line, latest at the time, supercomputer, super laptop. And I'll never forget that day when I got it. I opened it up, and I loaded it with all my favorite tools, my favorite word processors, my favorite Bible program, whatever, all these things that I've grown dependent upon. And they all came up and ran recognizably, comfortably, except there were a couple of interesting changes. They ran over 100 times faster than I was used to. And they were in full color. I'll never forget that. And I was blown away. And the reason I bring this up is I want to share with you out here in the audience, you too are heading for an upgrade. The real you is recognizable, it's personal, it won't change in a sense. Yet you're heading for an upgrade. And now the reason I want to get into this a little bit, there's some software has, the real you is software, not hardware. Well, software, of course, includes self-modifying codes. It's generated from high-level languages down to the machine code in the computer world, which means its architecture cannot be inferred from the outside. If I buy a program, I can learn very limited things about how it's internally organized by running it, because I only can observe its external behavior. Same thing with you. The only way I can find out how the software is organized is to get the designer's manual. And this is the reason that the field of psychology is doomed to frustration, because it's attempting to understand your architecture from your external behavior. There's some other issues. Software has no mass. What do I mean by that? See, software can be translated through the airwaves. I can have a little antenna here and I can operate my computer wirelessly. Software, as well as information, travels through the airway. It has no mass, intrinsic mass. Now, see, if I took a diskette, and see, I hold up a little red diskette here. You've all seen a diskette. If I put a blank diskette on a postal scale, it'll weigh about 7/10 of an ounce. Okay. If I spend hundreds of dollars and load that diskette with over 1 million bytes of software and put it on a personal scale, it'll weigh what? 7/10 of an ounce. See, that software has no mass. It's like a light switch that's on or off. It's a 1 or a 0. It doesn't change the weight of the light switch. There's no mass to the software. It's information that's mass-free. So software has no mass. Now, why am I emphasizing that? We just learned a little while ago that time is a physical property. The real you is software, not hardware. The real you has no mass. Now, it may be resident, in like my case, in a little too much mass. But the intrinsic me is mass-free, which means that the real me is eternal, whether I'm saved or not. That's the problem. Now, we talk about the body, soul, and spirit. Physical death is when the body is separated from the soul. The soul and the spirit can be separated, and that's what they call the second death in the scripture. And the soul is united with another body at the resurrection. And there's resurrection for the unsaved as well as the saved, which leads us to, okay, what happens next? I want to talk, before we leave this topic and get ready for the next session, I want to leave one other idea with you that's kind of provocative. And then I want to talk a little bit more about the physics of immortality. Frank J. Tipler is a professor of mathematical physics at Tulane University. He's one of these guys, brilliant guys, that's an expert in cosmology, astrophysics, information sciences. He's not a believer. He's one of these typical, very brilliant, atheistic professors. He undertook a project to try to reconcile what we think we know about the Big Bang, as they call it, which is a group of models of how things started, or they think things started, with the ultimate heat death of the universe. There's two different schools of thought about, and he's trying to put these together into one comprehensive model. And using just the most advanced and sophisticated methods in physics, and exactly the way that a physicist tries to determine, say, the properties of an electron. Using these tools, he made two discoveries that shocked him. The first, as he got into this project and tried to put this all together, he feels he discovered proof of the existence of God. And when he says that in terms of the Judeo-Christian concept of God. Now you may say, gee, that's no surprise. You know, a lot of bright guys have discovered God. That's, you know, no kidding, Dick Tracy, you know. And I usually equip anybody with anybody that's discovered God is a result of a miracle of the Holy Spirit. If you got a PhD, it's even a bigger miracle. Okay. But the second discovery he made really startled many. He also now believes, because of a study, he's talking about the study of physics, not the Bible or any of that sort of thing. He also believes that every human being who ever lived will be resurrected from the dead. And he concludes that from just what we think we understand about physics itself. So he published a book called The Physics of Immortality. I don't recommend the book for a certain number of reasons. First of all, you have to really have an appetite for differential equations if you're into that. But even so, you can learn more about the subject from the most important chapter in the Bible than from his book. What's the most important chapter in the Bible? 1 Corinthians 15, according to Paul. Because if you don't have that, you have nothing. And so, the physics of immortality. Well, that's what comes next then. Okay, then the question is, okay, given all this background of what we think we know about reality, what happens when we die? What does that mean? And is there really a hell? And what will heaven be like? And how do we prepare ourselves for that? And with this first session was a backgrounder to get into that one, which we'll take up in the next session. Well, we're in part two of our series on death and dying and so forth. Part two, we call the mystery of our destiny. What's our predicament today? And there is a dark side to all of this, of course. We realize that we are vulnerable to a deceiver. We have an adversary. And this adversary isn't the typical devil or Satan that get pictured in the literature or in Halloween or whatever. He can masquerade as the angel of light. And his basic technique is deception. So we're entering an area that in which deception is our primary tool of our adversary. So we run into all kinds of information that in modern terms is called channeling. and spiritism and all this sort of thing is in the periphery of our discussion here. But in Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Isaiah, 1 Corinthians, shreds that as being prohibited. Not just something you shouldn't do, it was punishable by death in ancient Israel. And among these things is communication with the dead. It's disturbing how many, even Christians, think that that's an okay kind of thing to try. And clearly, it is not. Deuteronomy 18 expressly prohibits it. Many people get confused by the peculiar episode in 1 Samuel 28 with Saul and the witch at Endor, where Saul consults a medium. But in this case, God intervenes, and some very strange events occur that even the medium is shook, and announces to Saul, that is, God announces to, or Samuel announces to Saul, that he will die the following day. So it's clearly that a very, very spooky passage in 1 Samuel 28, worth your study, but certainly does not endorse or encourage this idea of necromancy. And as we touch on these topics, which are peripheral to our central issue, I want to just underscore that there are issues here that are dangerous, because some of you may be familiar with the novel, William Blatty's novel called The Exorcist, that was made into a movie. I was on the board of Walter Martin's ministry at the time when he set out to debunk that, because he was very upset by it for a number of reasons. And he was startled to discover that William Blatty had done his homework. It was built on a composite of several real-life case studies. And you may recall in the story, all those horrible things came about. It all got started because this child was messing around with a Ouija board. So things like Ouija boards, Dungeons and Dragons, some of these games, are not harmless toys. And that's why some people are so concerned about the Harry Potter series that are so popular as Christian stories and so forth, is that they're dangerous. They're websites and so forth that encourage serious involvement in witchcraft and such. These things are called entries, and they can damage lives, and they can be used by what I'll call the dark side to our adversity. So, and reincarnation is another one of these. We joked about it earlier. But clearly the scripture in Hebrews 9:27, it is appointed unto man but once to die, and then the judgment. There's no recycling going on here. That's a myth out of the pit of hell. And so we do encounter, especially lately, lots of books and materials on the so-called near-death experiences. And I'm not going to catalog or get into those, because they are, at best, doubtful sources of information on the subject that we're pursuing. There are some near-death experiences that are authenticated. There's one in Acts chapter 7, when young Stephen has given his presentation to the Sanhedrin. He gives the most august Jewish body of that time a lesson or a review of Old Testament history. And they interrupt him and have him stoned. And as he's stoned, in Acts chapter 7, verse 56, he sees Jesus Christ standing, waiting for him. So this idea that a Christian that dies is immediately greeted by the Lord himself on the other side of that portal is scriptural. Stephen's an example of that. Paul is another example. He talks about in 2 Corinthians 12 that there was an occasion 14 years earlier. He speaks of it in the third person, but clearly it's him caught up into what he calls the third heaven. That was a Greek term, because that first heaven was considered the sky where the birds fly, the second heaven the stars. The third heaven is the heaven that you and I think of as heaven. And he was caught up there, only to hear things that that could not be uttered. And it's interesting that he says it was 14 years earlier, and if you do your homework in Acts 14, it's that 14 years earlier he was at Lystra, where he was stoned and left for dead. And scholars argue that it may have been a near-death experience, or he actually may have been resurrected from the dead, because they left him and thought he was dead. So whether it is or not, that's a scholastic debate. But clearly, that may be what gave rise to Paul's experience that he records in 2 Corinthians 12. But as we go into any other sources than the scripture, let's be on our guard, because Satan's primary weapon is deception. And his agenda is to have you destroyed. That's his goal. And he has incredible resources to try to bring that about. And so he would like you to believe that there is no such thing as a judgment, that there is no real accountability to our Creator. Anything that tends to suggest that has as its origin Satan's lie, all the way to Genesis chapter 3, his first lie, which was to create doubt. Yea, hath God said that? And then direct denial. Ye shall not surely die, he tells Adam, which of course was a lie. And you know, it's interesting, the other idea that Satan would like you to believe is that there are many paths to God. And Jesus talked about that. He says, broad is the way, and wide is the gate that leads to destruction, Jesus said. Narrow is the gate that leads to salvation. And so we need, if you're going through a gate that's very popular and lots of people are joining you, be careful. You probably have the wrong gate. So let's move on here. We talked last in our previous session about a 10-dimensional universe. The original creation may well have been far broader than we know today. And when Adam fell, when Adam submitted to Satan, then this was fractured in the minds of some analysts. The four dimensions that you and I experience, length, width, height, and time, that we would call the physical universe, were separated from six other dimensions that we know exist but can't get at directly, and sometimes called the hyperdimensions. The biblical term would be the spiritual world, which is all-encompassing. It's a broader, more inclusive term, where the physical universe is a subset, if you will, of the total. What are the effects of the fall? Well, first of all, the possibilities that the universe was fractured. Separation of four and six dimensions is a suggestion by some. Separation of the physical and the spiritual. But one of the things that a group of us believe is that was also at Genesis chapter 3 of the fall of Adam is when the bondage of decay was instituted. In modern terms, we call that the entropy laws, the second law of thermodynamics. And the reason we believe that is because of Romans 8, which describes that the creation itself is waiting the day when it'll be relieved from its bondage of decay, is the term Paul uses. And that's so descriptive of the entropy laws. And so that's a possibility I'm suggesting. But the main point I'd like to get across is the redemption. God's plan of redemption involves more than just you and me. It involves a new creation. Isaiah and also John in Revelation says, I see a new heavens and a new earth. It's not just you and I and the earth. Even the heavens apparently are recreated, a new heavens and a new earth. So there's much more going on here that's in God's interest. Now, one of the things that we do when we go through the first chapter of Genesis, when we study it carefully, we notice that we have there the gradual introduction of order. Entropy is the opposite of order. It's randomness or chaos. So on a chart with entropy maximized at the bottom and minimized at the top, we see those days as step-by-step improvements in less entropy, reducing entropy. And so there is a major change that occurs at the fall. Everything we know about the creation is post-curse. We have very little insight as to what the creation was like prior to Genesis chapter 3. You can't prove to me that Adam lived in only three dimensions. I'm not saying he did, but we just don't know. We do know that he apparently was clothed with light, so that when he lost that, he knew he was naked in a much more profound sense than simply that he had no clothes on. And so history as we know it really starts from Genesis 3 and following. And there's a second place where the entropy, the disorder is introduced, and that, of course, is at the flood. The flood of Noah involved far more than just a lot of water. Some major changes occurred in the basic ecology of the planet Earth, which is a study in and of itself. And of course, it's been decaying since then. All of us are victims, if you will, of these little charts in National Geographic or Scientific American or what have you, of the ascent of man, the caveman that gradually grows up to be modern man. And while we reject evolution as such, we still find ourselves subject to these misconceptions. It could very well be that ancient man was far brighter, certainly far more sophisticated spiritually than we are today. It's been a decline, not an ascent. But let's go to Genesis 3 a little bit, which is the seed plot of the entire Bible. And of course, the villain of the piece is the Nahash, the shining one, one that later becomes the serpent and so forth. And the whole story of the forbidden fruit, which was emblematic of their rebellion, their failure to stay in subjection to the Creator himself. It's interesting to study carefully the methodology of our adversary. Two primary steps. His first was to introduce doubt. He said to Eve, yea, hath God said? That's called doubt. And then as soon as he got that beachhead, he then went into direct denial. Ye shall not surely die. God lied to you. And That's exactly the procedure that Satan uses today. It's exactly the kind of deception you and I are vulnerable to if we don't carefully cling to the Word of God itself. Now, the result of Adam's fall, of course, was God declaring war on Satan. Notice the initiatives on God's part. And in Genesis 3, verse 14, 15, he declares war, and there are two participants that will emerge from that declaration, the seed of the woman, which becomes the title of Jesus Christ, and the seed of the serpent. In Genesis 3, verse 14, it says, "The Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly thou shalt go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." And here we have an allusion to the seed of the woman, which is a contradiction not only in grammar, but in biology. Because obviously, but this is a hint here of the virgin birth, which Isaiah will pick up on, and of course becomes a primary thread in the New Testament. But many people overlook that there's two seeds here. The other seed is the seed of the serpent, who will bruise his head, but thou shalt bruise his heel, which of course happened at the cross. So we want to be, there's a whole study that you can get into on that one. But the basics are, the fall of man is the basis of death. Death was not originally intended. God is, death is a result of the fall of man. Death is an inescapable fact. We mentioned that from Hebrews 9:27, is appointed unto man but once to die, and after this the judgment. Science will never conquer death. That's mentioned in Job 14 and Ecclesiastes 3, but I think it's pretty self-evident if that's the cause of it. And death is man's punishment for disobedience. Romans 5 hammers on that, Romans 6, James 1, and so on. Now, the point you want to get across here is death is separation of the body and the soul. Separation is not annihilation. There's some that would like to cling to the appealing idea that losing is to cease to exist. Unfortunately, it's not that simple. Now, the sufficiency of Christ's atonement, which is the primary theme of the Bible from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, the sufficiency of Christ's atonement undercuts any theory of reincarnation or transmigration. Hebrews 1:3, 1 John 1:7, 1 Peter 2:24 are just a few examples where that's nailed, if you will. Now, there are some terms that occur that always get translated hell and thus get cause confusion in the English translations. So let's examine a few terms that we need to get straight in our minds. The first is the Hebrew term, Sheol. It is not the grave. The grave is the destination of the body. The Sheol is the destination of the soul. The location of the departed souls, the abode of the dead, both good and bad, is said in the Hebrew to be Sheol. Many people get confused about this. The first place it occurs in the scripture, which is always a highly relevant occasion, what they call the law of first mention, occurs in Genesis 37:35, when Jacob is confronted with the apparent death of Joseph. They bring his garments and convince him that he's been killed. It's clear that Jacob assumes that his son was still conscious after death in his remarks, and that he would ultimately be united with him. This is useful. Now, Joseph really wasn't killed, but he didn't know that. But the point is, it reveals his whole conception. Jacob assumes that his son was still conscious after death, very important. And he also takes for granted that he will ultimately be united with him when they're both dead. Now, the term Sheol could not mean grave because he'd apparently been devoured by an animal. There's nothing to bury. So the Sheol does not mean grave. By the way, he is still his son. After death, we still retain the relationships, father, son, children, and so forth. Still retained his identity. And Jacob also says he will go down to Sheol. Again, we find that the word Sheol, as the Greek word, equivalent word is Hades, are geocentric concepts. It's as if it's down there in the center of the earth. That's maybe not literal, but it's certainly idiomatically the way they view it. Now, the opposite is kever, which is grave. It's not synonymous. In fact, it's the obvious. In the Septuagint, that's the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament, Sheol is never translated Menema, which it's always translated as Hades. And it's always contrasted, never equated with Sheol, that is, kever is. And Sheol is under the earth, underworld, lower parts of the earth, and all through the scripture. sepulchres in those days were in caves or above the earth, interestingly enough. So they're not even geometrically the same. Sheol is always the opposite of grave in that one sense, and it's the opposite of heaven in another. Now, the word kever or keeper means to bury. It's never used of Sheol. It can be pluralized. You can have multiple graves. Sheol is never pluralized. There's only one Sheol. Grave is located in a specific site. Sheol is never localized. Grave is accessible at death no matter where death takes place. Sheol is accessible wherever death takes place. No grave is necessary to go to Sheol, as example is Joseph with Jacob. And one can purchase or sell a grave. Sheol is never spoken of as being purchased or sold. You can own a grave as personal property. Sheol, nowhere is Sheol owned by a man. And bodies are unconscious in the grave, but those that are in Sheol are conscious. In Isaiah 14 and 44, Ezekiel 31 and 32, and Luke 16 that we'll look at shortly, the consciousness of people after death is crucial on both sides of this coin. Now, the Greek equivalent term is Hades. In classic Greek, it has to do with Pluto, the god of the lower regions, or Orcus, the netherworld, the realm of the dead in classic Greek. But in biblical Greek, it's the infernal regions, the dark and dismal place in the very depths of the earth, the common receptacle of what? Disembodied spirits of whatever kind. Understand that Hades has a good, both Sheol and Hades receive both good and bad people. That's what throws a lot of people, because they're both, often the word Sheol in the English translation is translated grave. That's unfortunate because it's very misleading. The word Hades is usually translated hell in the English, and that's also misleading for some reasons we'll get to. But in either case, Hades also, just like Sheol, is a geocentric concept. It's as if they're in the center of the earth, at least idiomatically. Now, there's another term that Christ uses as distinct from Hades. It's the word Gehenna. And the word Gehenna originally referred to the Valley of Hinnom, which was south of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, as you know, is surrounded by three valleys. The Kidron Valley on the east towards the Mount of Olives, the Hinnom Valley to the south, and Teropian Valley on the west. But the southern valley had a pretty dismal history. First of all, it was where the dumped filth and dead animals and so forth, everything that was cast out would sit there, and it was always burning. And it also was the place where at one time in Israel's history, they offered their children to the god of Moloch, this bronze statue that they heated up red hot and put the babies in his arms. And it was also done there at the Valley of Hinnom. So it has this dark, sinister history. It also became the city dump, if you will. And so it becomes, there are 12 occurrences of this word in the New Testament. 11 of the 12 are by the Lord himself using it as an idiom for not the literal valley there, but as the ultimate destiny of the unsaved. Now, the unsaved are temporarily held in Hades or Sheol, Hades in the Greek, Sheol in the Hebrew, but the ultimate destiny later will be in the lake of fire, as it's often translated. The lake that burns with fire and brimstone and so forth. The word is often Gehenna there. Now, interestingly enough, topologically, Gehenna is the opposite of Hades. Hades is in the center of the earth. Gehenna is in the outer darkness. So the two, I want you to get, they're very distinctively different. And now, you need to understand that Gehenna was specifically prepared as the destiny of Satan and his angels. Matthew 25:41, Jesus says, "Then shall he say also to them on the left hand, Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." So people that go there will be people that have disregarded God's provision to the contrary. Now, in Revelation 20, as the big climax finishes in Revelation, death and hell, that's Hades, are cast into Gehenna. That's called the second death there. So even Hades is temporary. Sheol and Hades are temporary. They're destined to be cast into Gehenna, in the outer darkness. Now, obviously, we find fire and brimstone all through the scriptures so frequently that you can't dismiss it, the fire that never gets quenched. And I don't want to imply that there isn't a real fire, but I'm going to also suggest to you that they are metaphors that what they really involve may be far more serious than any fire you and I have any conception of. The beast and the false prophet are thrown in those fires at the beginning of 1,000 years. Satan's bound for 1,000 years and then released for a while. And he joins them after 1,000 years, and when he joins them, they're still there burning. So it's a fire that never consumes. So it's a very different kind of experience. I suspect that hell will be greater than all the weak and feeble metaphors that the human language can provide. We just recognize that. How else can we characterize the ultimate alienation from God outside the limitations of time and space? We have no capacity to imagine that. These may be metaphors to get across it. But there is one report that's very thorough. Most of what we think we know comes from the Lord Jesus Christ himself in his narrative about the rich man and Lazarus in Luke 16. And I want to emphasize right up front that this is not a parable. In parables, the participants don't have names. In Luke 16, starting at verse 19, Jesus said, There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus. He's got a name, so this is a real person, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with crumbs, which fell from the rich man's table. And moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried. So that's the setup. That's the background here. Not a parable, a real event. The rich man in hell, in Hades in the Greek, he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. Now this is interesting. Somehow, this isn't hidden from him, whether he literally see him or he's somehow conscious of the fact that Abraham's over there and Lazarus got it made. He's in his predicament. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. So again, it's a fire idiom going on here. He begs Abraham. And obviously Abraham can hear him because he's going to reply. He also recognizes that Lazarus is there. Just, can you give Lazarus this errand on my behalf, he says. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received the good things, and likewise Lazarus the evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. So apparently they can communicate, but there is an impassable gulf between them. You know, it's interesting, the rich man in no way says it's unjust. No way is he complaining that this is unfair. He's just acknowledging that he's in torment. And he goes on here in verse 27. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. Okay, Lazarus can't come see me. Send him to my father's house, for I have 5 brothers, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come unto this place of torment. The rich man knows he's got a father. He remembers his brothers. They're on his heart. That's his primary concern, that they don't get what he's got. Send Lazarus to them. He apparently understands that if they listen to Lazarus and repent, they can avoid this destiny. See, there's a tremendous amount of information here. The rich man knows his destiny. He knows it's permanent. He asks for Lazarus to warn his family so they don't fall into this mess. Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. He said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. That's the rich man's assessment. Someone actually came back from the dead, that would impress them, see? Mm-hmm. Abraham said to them, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. It's interesting, of course, you can't miss the situation that there was a different Lazarus that was raised from the dead. There's another concept that undergirds this, by the way. See, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, and they still won't believe, then sending them a witness from the dead will increase their punishment. You see, the withholding of that is a form of mercy. In Matthew 13, some events occur. From Matthew 13 on, Jesus spoke only in parables. And when you read Matthew 13 carefully, you'll discover that he explains to his disciples the reason he speaks in parables is so that they hearing, they won't understand. You say, that's a little weird. No, see, he knows they won't believe. And by speaking in parables, it lessens their punishment for not believing. If he's clearer and knowing they still won't believe, it'll deepen their punishment. It's strangely enough, it's elliptically an act of mercy. Bizarre, isn't it? Let's talk about the underworld. As we understand it from Luke 16, obviously there's an underworld there. There's a place in the Greek we call Hades, or in the Hebrew Sheol. It's obviously includes, but not limited to, a place of torment. That's where the rich man is. But there's also a place, I'll call it the good side, that is called there Abraham's bosom. He's the father of all the faithful. So those that are faithful are in his bosom. And we get the impression clearly from Luke 16 that in Hades there's a good side and a bad side. And between the two, there is an impassable gulf. See, that's why translating Hades as hell is misleading in the English, because we think of hell in the absolute negative sense, which of course it is. Hades is the abode, is equivalent to the Hebrew term Sheol. It's the abode of the dead. We've got the place of torment for the bad guys, so to speak, the wicked, those that are destined for torment through eternity, and those that are in Abraham's bosom, which are awaiting an event that I'll talk about in a minute. And you can't get from one side to the other. It's determined. Not changeable. That's important. There are some other terms that come up, and let me bring them up here to avoid future confusion. There's also a term called the abuso in the Greek, typically translated the bottomless pit. And we find certain creatures are consigned to the abuso, which apparently is not necessarily part of Hades, or if it is, it's a deeper, deeper part. It's also the place from which the Antichrist comes, interestingly enough, in Revelation 11 and 17 and so forth. There's another term that shows up in the New Testament only once. Peter uses the term Tartarus. Most scholars presume from what he says it's probably equivalent to the bottomless pit. But to the Greeks, Tartarus it's the only place it occurs in the New Testament, but it's used in the Greek literature, and it is regarded as a place that is as far below Hades as the earth is below heaven. So what is it? I don't know, but I don't want to go there. That term probably comes out of Homer's Iliad. So as a Greek vocabulary, it's a deep, deep, special, dark place that God has reserved for certain purposes. So now, some insights. I want to summarize what we learned from Luke 16. The man in Hades was fully conscious. He wasn't asleep. He had memory. He could speak. He experienced pain. He also experienced desires. And some of the most painful part of this may be the unfulfilled desires. His eternal destiny was irrevocably fixed. No reprieve. Not even discussed. He also apparently knew what he was experiencing was fair and just. He also knew what his brothers needed to do to avoid his own fate, namely repent. Interesting, there's a lot of interesting. And by the way, he wasn't in hell yet. He was in that bad side of Hades. Now there's another thing that occurs at the cross. It's generally regarded by most conservative Bible scholars that between the time that Jesus died on the cross and that he rose that Easter morning, that he emptied Abraham's bosom. He took those faithful that were accumulated in Abraham's bosom to himself. Where do we get that? Well, let's talk about it. In 1 Peter 3, Peter writes, "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. Now, when it says preached, we always think of preaching as trying to change somebody's mind. No, the word there just means declare. Jesus went down there to declare his victory on the cross, his victory over death. That, by the way, was prophesied also. You may recall when Jesus was, when he opened his ministry in Nazareth, in Luke chapter 4, in the synagogue, he gets the copy of Isaiah, and he finds the place that we call Isaiah 61, and he reads it as his mandate for his ministry. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And that's where he stops, at that comma in Luke. What he didn't read is, "and the day of vengeance of our God." His ministry mandate was up to that comma, which is what he did. His second coming, he'll deal with the day of vengeance of our God. So he's yet to do that, but that's yet future. But you'll notice this proclaiming liberty to the captives and opening prison bound. That's where most scholars feel that's what happened when he cleaned out Abraham's bosom, because the thief on the cross was going to be with him in paradise that very day, remember? See? Now, there's a very strange two-verse passage in Matthew 27 that no one knows what it means. We can only speculate. But it mentions there that, speaking of the crucifixion and the earthquakes and all that, says, "And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city and appeared unto many." We have no other reference to that. We can only speculate what it refers to. Many scholars, John Walvoord pointed out that Jesus, on his resurrection, was the first fruits. That Sunday morning was the morning after Shabbat. It was the Feast of First Fruits. So Jesus clearly was their first fruits, but the word first fruits is plural. And Walvoord makes a Levitical kind of argument that he would be the first of a group to be a true first fruits offering. And so this plurality, Walvoord used to point to this, that these, it happens to be inserted during the description of the crucifixion, but it really alludes to something that happened after the resurrection, that came out of the graves after his resurrection, went into the holy city, and so forth. And so this indeed may also be some of those that were in Abraham's bosom up till then. Now we're plunging right into this difficult area of the doctrine of hell. And pastors typically will reluctantly acknowledge it, because it's clear the scripture says flee from the wrath to come and so forth. But as a result of it not being mentioned more, most people treat it strangely with indifference. It's a touchy subject. It's a tough, unpleasant subject. So we don't talk about it much. And because we're indifferent to it, there's widespread ignorance on this whole topic and all its ramifications. And because of the ignorance, we have doubt. Many people, many Christians, don't really believe in a hell. And they're thus in denial. They have several ways they try to get around this. And because of the denial, it gets to be an irritable subject, and that brings you right back to the lack of acknowledgement and so forth. So this is a tragic cycle that we're in within the body of Christ, within the church. Let's talk a little bit about the justice of God. There will be a last judgment. Every person is going to be resurrected and judged individually. Every hour of every life, every hidden thought, every motive, words spoken in secret will be made public. There'll be no misinterpretations. All court cases will be retried, I suppose. All blame will be accurately proportioned. There'll be no unsolved crimes. There'll be no hidden bribes. The accounting of every detail of each of our lives, every thought, every motive, and so forth, but also what everyone did with what they knew. To whom much was given, much is required. Did you know that all religions lead to God? Oh, they do indeed. The problem is, it won't be Buddha, Confucian, or Muhammad, or whoever. It'll be Jesus Christ as judge. All religions are going to lead to the judgment, and the guy sitting on the judgment seat will not be any of these leaders. It'll be the person of Jesus Christ himself. Now the Father, we know from John 5:27, the Father has given all authority for the judgment to Jesus Christ. So he's got the whole ball game here. Now, there's two judgment seats. At the Bema seat, all believers are rewarded because the ones that are there are saved. They're simply rewarded for their performance. They're not there because of their performance, but since they're there, they'll receive rewards. And we'll talk about that shortly in 1 Corinthians 3. And we'll look at that shortly. At the end of the millennium, there's the great white throne judgment, which consigns the wicked are resurrected and judged and consigned to their eternal state. This final exam is very real. Jesus said, I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Boy, boy. That's scary. Romans 1. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. And professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. This is all coming home to roost at this final judgment. No exceptions. Everyone's going to be there. Now, by the way, Paul will later in Romans chapter 10, he'll quote Deuteronomy 30. The thrust of both his quote and also the original that he's quoting from is that men will be held accountable by the creation. He's accountable, but you can point to many other things, but that alone is enough to consign them to their eternal punishment, the failure to acknowledge the Creator. Peter comments in a similar vein in 2 Peter 3, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Very interesting verse there, because it links the concept of prophecy, the second coming, with the concept of the creation. See, they both presume God intervening in human history. But Peter goes on and says, For this they willingly are ignorant of that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water, in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. He goes on. Willingly ignorant is the key phrase here. People who deny God are doing it as a decision. It's not an intellectual thing, it's a choice thing. Let's talk more about this punishment. We know that the punishment is conscious. It includes passions, desires, memories, and regrets. It's eternal. Dante, in his literature, summarized it so well in one way. He says, he had it pictured that over the doorway, it says, abandon all hope who enter here. We have no ability to imagine what it's like to be without hope. I was had an opportunity at the Angola prison, the famous prison, largest maximum security place in the world. And I had a chance to meet 13 of the people on death row, some of which had been there for 9 years with a pardon granted by the parole board but not signed by the governor. Obviously not likely to be for a lot of reasons. Even there, even in that, what you and I would consider a hopeless situation, they're still cling to a threat. They're just maybe. Now here, you and I can't imagine being totally without hope of any kind. One of the part of the punishment is to be exposed for your own sin for eternity, disconnected from all painkillers and so forth. There's been a number of summaries trying to summarize all that we think we know about the impenitent. Certainly, they'll be suffered from the loss of all earthly good, from the utter expulsion from the presence and favor of God. We can't imagine what that's like, because we probably don't realize that every cell division in our body involves God's intervention. We can't imagine being disconnected from the source of all life, from the utter withdrawal of the Holy Spirit. We can't imagine that. For the consequent unrestrained dominion of sin and sinful passions. Our own sin, our own sinful passions may be the source of a large portion of our punishment. From the operations of our conscience, from despair, from evil associates, from external circumstances, and from their perpetuity, they never cease. This is just one summary by Charles Hodge, there's others. There's distributive justice, we call that mercy, God's grace. There's the retributive justice, and that's what we're talking about here. Why? For at least three reasons. To vindicate the king's righteousness. And the king of the universe, who has an intrinsic nature of righteousness. So it calls for these to be either paid for or performed. Also, to defend the moral order of his kingdom. This is essential when you think that through. And also is essential in order to highlight the preciousness of the servant who died to make us just. Can't compromise any one of those three. It's not in God's nature. See, God loves everybody. He loves his son more. And he's going to vindicate the price that his son paid on our behalf. This retributive justice is the response of positive holiness, reasserting the moral order of the world against all that is evil. Can evil be forgiven? No. Satan and his angels are consigned there. They clearly are there forever. There's no compromise here. There are degrees of punishment. Not all are equal. To whom much is given, much will be required. We've talked about that. Clearly, there's degrees of punishment. And I mentioned even earlier that even withholding truth can be an act of mercy. Because if there's a truth, and God knows you're not going to believe it anyway, giving you that truth increases the punishment you're destined to. So that's a reality. 2 Corinthians 8:12 is an interesting verse. It says, "For if there first be a willing mind, it is accepted according to what a man hath, not according to what he hath not." But there are difficulties for all of us. We all, if we're honest with ourselves, have difficulties with this concept of eternal punishment. Does the punishment fit the crime is our question. Well, that really begs a different question. Do we really understand God's attitude towards sin? I don't think so. Remember, adultery was a capital crime in Israel. We wouldn't even think of doing that in our culture. We can't handle that. If we did, we'd probably cut the population less than half. Horoscopes were a capital crime. I won't ask for a show of hands how many people take a glance at the paper to see what their horoscope is. They just as a piece of entertainment or something. Every major paper has a horoscope column. In ancient Israel, to cast a horoscope made you punishable to death. God doesn't mess around. He took these things seriously. You see, our sensitivity to sin is calloused by our culture and our attitudes. See, what we fail to understand is two things we fail to understand. We don't understand the magnitude of sin on the one hand, but here's the real corker. We can't appreciate the majesty of God on the other. Part of the seriousness of sin isn't just the intrinsic in the sin itself, it's who is it against. And when it's against an infinite being, you see, sin is a violation of the character of an infinite being. Then we begin to get the message here, this serious stuff going on. A God deserving of worship cannot issue an arbitrary amnesty for humanitarians or pantheists who persist in worshiping and serving themselves more than their personal creator himself. The condemnation of everyone who is lost will be wholly attributable to himself or herself for having disregarded God's revealed will. And that will is sufficiently revealed just in the creation itself. That's the shocker to me. As you read your Bible, oh boy, there's lots of visibility. But it really amazed me that the Bible takes the position that just the creation itself is enough revelation for you to respond to. Now, people have contrived reasons to disbelieve. They come in three categories. One is called materialism. I'm not using it the way we would use it in terms of our cultural sense. Philosophy, it deals with the fact that the only real world is the material world. That's what that word means there. Well, that simply is an ignorance of the nature of reality. That term is really, in today's world, just being uninformed as the discoveries of modern physics. But in the two that are more common, one is called universalism. That's an attempt to take the forever out of hell. And annihilationism, which attempts to take the hell out of forever. These are two attempts to get around what the Bible clearly teaches. Well, let's talk about universalism. which says essentially different ways of saying that eventually all will arrive, you know, safely to heaven. And you can't take that seriously for lots of reasons, but not the least of which, Satan and his angels would ultimately have to be reconciled to be God to God themselves, and they clearly are not. It's not going to happen. Why? Because Christ did not die for them. Hebrews 2:16. The beast and the false prophet were tormented day and night for 1,000 years until Satan joins them, and they were still there. And they are clearly tormented forever. And the Greek is not ambiguous in that term. Also, universalism would contradict the Great Commission. Universalism has never been widely accepted among serious students of the Word of God, so it's not a real problem except to the uninformed. And all the supporting scriptures that are sometimes mustered in these discussions are taken totally out of context. It's not a serious apologetic debate. Annihilationism is a whole other ballgame. It's sort of an attempt to talk about conditional immortality. It sounds like an oxymoron, doesn't it? And the key verse they love to pick on is Matthew 10:28. It says, "Fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both the soul and the body in hell." And Clark Pinnock and a number of liberals hang on that verse to try to sell annihilationism as a possibility, except they're not doing a competent exegetical job here. The term in the Greek as the polemi, which means to be delivered up to eternal misery, not destroy in the sense of annihilate. It is never used to mean annihilate. It's used in Matthew 9:17, Luke 15:4, and John 6 twice. And so it means to be delivered up to eternal misery, destroyed in that sense. I'm going to destroy your career, sort of as a way we might use an equivalent term. No, it doesn't mean destroy. It does not mean annihilate. Annihilationism is refuted by a number of passages. Matthew 20, just a few verses later, Matthew 25, verse 46, being, "These shall go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous unto eternal life." And in both cases, the word is aionios, which is everlasting or eternal. Same word is used for eternal punishment and eternal life. You can't escape the linkage. The same meaning. Same thing in the Old Testament, in Daniel 12. "Many of them asleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and shame, and some to shame and everlasting contempt." Everlasting in both cases, same Hebrew word. And of course, Revelation 14, "The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture unto the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels, in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. They have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." Nothing temporary about this. Pretty serious language. "The devil was that deceived and was cast in the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever." The beast and the prophet have been there for 1,000 years when this happens. And they're still there burning. Well, we talked about the paradigm of death, where we have the physical death, the separation of the soul and the body, and spiritual death, the soul and the spirit, and then the soul is resurrected for its ultimate death. But that's not for the believer. See, the believer has the Holy Spirit indwelling. And so indeed, he may experience physical death in terms of being separation from the body. But that's as far as it goes. Why? The second death was paid for on the cross. Jesus went there for us. So let's get to heaven a little bit. We've been in some pretty grim footage here. Let's take a little look here at some other things. The joys of heaven. It's a newly created environment that will be unsullied by any kind of moral evil. That itself speaks volumes. It'll include the ultimate model city. We see this New Jerusalem, and I'll show you a few renderings of that, but let me tell you, they don't come close. We'll enjoy a deathless existence in our resurrection bodies, and I'll talk a little bit about our resurrection bodies. We'll be knowing and loving God maximally. Boy, that's probably the best part of it all. We'll have fellowship with other believers. Now, I know there's some believers you just soon skip, but we'll all have lost our sin nature by then. We apparently will retain our gender and personal and ethnic characteristics. That's interesting, but there's scripture that seems to indicate that. We'll have renewed intellectual, emotional, and volitional abilities, and that's also very exciting. But I do want to touch a little bit about children, because many of us are concerned about children. I get a lot of questions about this. Remember David's son in 2 Samuel 12. As long as the son was ill, he prayed and fasted. As soon as the son died, he scrubbed up and went back to work. And the servants were shocked. And he says, "Why are you so shocked? I will eventually join him." he knew that he would eventually join his son. Now, his son was a baby. Paul has a similar expression, which gives us confidence that children, while they're not before they're accountable, are saved. Paul, in Romans 7, where he talks about the whole role of the law and so forth, in verse 9 he says, "For I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died." When you analyze that carefully, the only time it could have been when Paul was before the age of accountability, he apparently was saved, because he wasn't regarded as having the law. Now, children are not innocent. They die, but their accountability is waived, because they're subject to death just like Adam, from Romans 5, 12, and elsewhere. But I want to share something that most people overlook that I've discovered is an incredible insight for some of you in the audience. The book of Job opens up. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright and one that feared God and eschewed evil. And there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance also was 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 she-asses, and very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. And you all know the story. Satan is allowed to, one by one, take away his good things and his family and even his health. We're sitting on this ash heap, and most of the book are these dialogues between these 3 characters that he calls his friends. With friends like that, you don't need enemies. And then near the end, of course, God speaks on behalf of Job. The last 4 chapters are fantastic chapters. But I want to get into all that here. Most of you, I think, are familiar with the basic story. But I want to show you in chapter 42, the last chapter of the book of Job. By now, the Lord has turned the captivity of Job and when he prayed for his friends. And also the Lord gave Job now twice as much as he had before, Scripture says. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. For he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 she-asses. Then it says in verse 13, he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. Well, if you've been paying attention, this bothers you a little bit. Because sheep, camels, oxen, and she-asses, he originally had 7,000, 3,000, 500 each of the last 2. And he had 7 sons and 3 daughters. When God restores double everything he had before, afterwards, he has 14,000 sheep rather than 7, 6,000 camels rather than 3,000, and 1,000 each of oxen and she-asses against the 500 before. So he's got twice as much of his livestock. And he gets 7 sons and 3 daughters. And if you've been paying attention, you look at that, gee, that doesn't seem right, because God gave him twice as much as he had before. You sort of feel he got shortchanged on the children thing, right? That's because we don't know how to count. Because he didn't lose the 7 sons and 3 daughters. They're in heaven waiting for him. When God doubles what he had, he gives him 7 more sons and daughters. It's counted double because he'll have 14 sons and 6 daughters when he gets to heaven. I mention that because some of us have lost a loved one. I think it was Carl Jung that said the death of a child is like putting a period before the end of a sentence. And God knows all about losing sons. Well, let me talk a little bit more about the geometry of eternity. We talked before about this line. Behind us is the past, ahead of us is the future. And God, of course, can see the end from the beginning. You recall this from the earlier session. I want you to notice something. I'm just going to suggest a speculative possibility to stretch your horizons here. Those arrows can point the other way. Somebody that died in the past, someone that died last week, and someone that gets raptured, say, 3 weeks from Tuesday, all could arrive at the throne simultaneously because they're outside the dimension of time as we know it. I'm not saying they do. There's lots of other aspects to this. But I suggest this to stretch your imaginations because we're going to move into some other strange directions here. We're going to talk about a resurrection body. What kind of bodies are we going to have? Well, we need to understand the lesson of Jurassic Park. Most of us have seen in Michael Crichton's novel, or either his movie or his novel. In Jurassic Park, these prehistoric creatures were created by a piece of information. The DNA embodied in blood in a mosquito that was embedded in amber for thousands of years, presumably. By taking that DNA, they could clone and recreate these creatures. That's the concept of the story. It's not a far stretch from science as we think of it. But the point it teaches is a couple of things. The molecules are fungible raw materials. Carbon atoms, hydrogen atoms, I don't measure which ones. Put those together for sugars or glucose or whatever. All that was needed was a piece of information. All God needs to resurrect you. He doesn't need your atoms that are decaying at the bottom of the ocean or in a grave or something. He needs your DNA, maybe a little more. And with that, he can recreate, resurrect your body. He doesn't have to use the hydrocarbon chemistry. I'm just using that as an example. In fact, it seems pretty clear he doesn't. He uses something else. We do know that our bodies are going to have more than three dimensions. How do we know that? Because Christ did. Christ in his resurrection was able to enter and leave a room without passing through the floor, ceiling, or the four walls. And they thought he was a ghost. He says, a ghost has not, have flesh and bone. Handle me and see. He is very tangible on the one hand, and yet he possesses dimensional qualities that absolutely defy our understanding, because we're limited to a three-dimensional concept here. He is not. Now, there's one of my favorite verses is 1 John 3:2. We'll look at it in a minute. There is a term in the Bible that only occurs twice. The word is okaterion in the Greek. In 2 Corinthians 5:2, it speaks of the body, the habitation we aspire to. In Jude verse 6, it's the body that the angels disrobe themselves from in order to participate in the mischief, is Genesis 6. We do know that we'll retain personal knowledge in our identities. Remember the transfiguration that disciples could recognize Moses and Elijah and so on. But 1 John 3:2 is a verse that tells far more than most people can extract from it before they realize what it's saying. John says in his first letter, he says, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear when we shall what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." We don't know what he's going to be like, but we know that when he will appear, we will be like him because we will see him as he actually is. What he's saying, we're not going to see a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional being like a picture. We're not going to see a three-dimensional representation of a four-dimensional being or whatever. We shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Whatever dimensionality he enjoys, so shall we. That's what this is saying. Wow, that's exciting. Now, I want to talk a little bit more about hyperspace. We talked about it a little bit last session, but there's only two kinds of people that can deal with hyperspaces, spaces of more than three dimensions: mathematicians with special training and small children. Okay? Now, you and I can't think of four or five, six dimensions, take special training. But we can get some insights by going down in our imagination rather than up. And I want to imagine a two-dimensional universe. And I'm going to introduce you to two friends of mine, and they suffer from a very serious handicap, so be kind. They only have two dimensions. They're Mr. and Mrs. Flat, okay? And I'm drawing here on some insights from Edwin Abbott, a churchman of the turn of the century, 20th century. He developed this in some interesting ways. But anyway, it's Mr. and Mrs. Flat. Now, they suffer because they only have they only live in two dimensions. Now, when Mr. Flat looks at Mrs. Flat, he doesn't see two dimensions. He sees one. He sees a one-dimensional image of a two-dimensional person. Just like you and I see a picture, that's a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional person, right? But there's something else about this thing. If I come along as a three-dimensional person, I can put my finger a millionth of an inch away from Mr. Flat, and my other finger a millionth of an inch away from Mrs. Flat, no matter where they are in their two-dimensional space. See, my proximity to either one is totally independent of the distance between them. I'd be closer to both of them than they can to each other, especially when they're separated. Do you understand? See the difference by having an additional dimension, what that does for me. There's some other things. If I poke my finger through their universe, the universe is only a two-dimensional universe, what will they see? Just a circle. You see? They can't see me. They only know of two dimensions. If I poke through, all they see is a circle, right? If a ball comes flying through their universe, it looks like a point that opens up to a circle and then closes down. They have no grasp of a three-dimensional object, right? You with me? See, they have a limitation only because they only have two dimensions. Now, I mentioned in the previous session, I mentioned about Paul in Ephesians 3:17-18, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. And you may recall that Paul apparently is sensitive, or at least the Holy Spirit writing through Paul is, that there are at least we live in four dimensions. Now, how do you communicate now a three-dimensional object to Mr. and Mrs. Flat? Pretty tough to do. I could do it maybe by a two-dimensional projection. I could take a three-dimensional object like a cube and give them a, you know, orthographic projection like an architect would, but that isn't that useful to them. They don't understand that. I could do a three-dimensional projection of the four-dimensional. That doesn't help. Doing a three-dimensional object in two dimensions doesn't help. If I'm trying to show you in three dimensions what a four-dimensional cube looks like, a hypercube as they call it, that doesn't help you much. Not very useful, is it? How am I going to communicate a three-dimensional object in two dimensions? One way I can do is I can unravel it. I can take the cube, the three-dimensional box, say, and I can fold it out the way you would a box and try to use that to communicate to them what three dimensions are. But you can tell it's not going to be too useful to Mr. and Mrs. Flat, is it? There is a way to take a four-dimensional cube, it's called a Hinton cube, and unravel it into three dimensions. Here's a four-dimensional cube unraveled in three dimensions. You say, well, is that the only place I've ever seen this useful, other than a mathematics textbook, is by Salvador Dali when he rendered his famous painting, Corpus Christi. He was sophisticated enough to realize that that's a multidimensional, it's a four-dimensional thing going on in three dimensions, which is kind of interesting. Well, people wanted pictures of the New Jerusalem. You see the classic renderings in the Renaissance art style. You find people talking about this cube that comes down, and it's got, you know, 1,500, it's got 12,000 furlongs on a side, yet the walls are 72 feet or whatever. It just doesn't compute. This is the Borg cube, for you Star Wars fans. That's the cube from the dark side, actually. But the point is, there's been people that try to render this, and the reason I haven't spent much time on this is because all of these people miss the point. This is not a three-dimensional cube. It's a residence of multi-dimensional bodies, you and I in Christ. So I wouldn't even try to render it in three dimensions. It's a waste of time. Well, let's wrap this up here. What is the gospel, the good news? No, the gospel is something very specific, and you will not hear it from most pulpits in America. Paul says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye have received, wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. Can you believe in vain? Absolutely. The devils also believe and tremble, James tells us. I declare unto you the gospel. The next few verses define what the gospel is. I deliver unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Three things: that he died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, he rose the third day. What's astonishing about this definition of the gospel, there's no mention of his example. Many people would acknowledge him, he's a wonderful example of many things. There's no mention of his teachings. Many people acknowledge he was the greatest teacher ever lived, or all that sort of thing. There's no mention of his miracles. Lots of people seem to go around doing miracles, it would seem. No, what is the gospel? That he died for our sins according to Scripture. He didn't disappear, he died, but he didn't just die. He died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Dozens of specifications were fulfilled in the way he died. The cross, the crucifixion on the cross, was not a tragedy, it was an achievement. Achievement by the Creator himself to facilitate our redemption. He was buried. Paul emphasized that because he makes a case of making an analogy there with baptism. And then he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. And then the rest of the chapter goes on. He was seen of Cephas and the 12, and that he was seen of the above 500 brethren all at once, of whom the greater part remain under this present, but some are fallen asleep. The people that he's writing to include eyewitnesses. There are 500 up in Galilee that saw him, and some of them are present in this church. The last of all he's seen of me also as one born out of due time. And now Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. As in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Adam was the son of God. The rest of us are sons of Adam. Sons of God is an Old Testament term by the B'nai Elohim. Was used of Adam and of angels, direct creations of God. You and I are not. You were descendants of Adam. We carry a sin defect. Jesus came unto his own, John tells us in John chapter 1. He came unto his own received him not. But as to as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God. It's a new birth. That's why the word born again is not just a figure of speech. It's very, very real. Anyway, but every man his own order. Christ the first fruits, and afterwards they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet, and the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Praise God. And he says, be sure, mystery, we shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. There's some, in other words, that will live where he makes a change. And in a moment, and twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. And we shall be changed, for this incorruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? And he's quoting there from some very well-known Greek poets in that day. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So God's, the first act of religion back in Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve tried to cover themselves, that was the first act of religion, man's attempt to cover himself with God. God's plan of redemption was to make coats and skins and teach them by the shedding of innocent blood they would be redeemed. On another tree, in another garden, they'd be covered. And from the seed of the woman, we have the whole story of God's redemption. From the seed of the woman, the call of Abraham, the tribe of Judah, the dynasty of David, the virgin birth, till we finally get to another tree in another garden, where the Lord Jesus Christ paid the price to give God the opportunity to extend to us a complete pardon for all our sins and to make us eligible for an eternal destiny with him rather than being alienated from him. And God has many attributes. Infinite power, we can imagine that. Infinite knowledge, we can imagine that. Creation manifests both of these. But how do you manifest infinite love? How does God demonstrate that? Knowing that if man was left free to choose, he would enter into a predicament that only the death of God could suffice to extricate him. Greater love hath no man than he that lays down his life for his friends. This whole manifestation is God's way of demonstrating infinite love. There's no salvation in any other. There's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. We have that present right now today. This is not something you get later. He that believeth on the Son already hath everlasting life. He that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. There's only two categories here. What's the basis of your faith? Well, I'm as good as the next guy. Really? Strike one. Well, I'm doing the best I can. Strike two. I try to live by the Ten Commandments, the Sermon on the Mount. Really? Strike three. You can't make it, but Christ has paid the price for you. According to the grace of God, which is given me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, another buildeth thereon, but let every man take heed on how he buildeth thereon. No other foundation can no man lay, than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, I put it this way, there's two different categories. There's six things, but they're in two different categories. Some are combustible, some aren't. Gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay, stubble. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. So what are you building on? Gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay, stubble? If any man's work abide which he hath built thereon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so is by fire. 1 Corinthians 3 is one of those passages we don't preach enough of, because it's all about rewards. You don't earn your way into heaven, but if you qualify for heaven by believing in Jesus Christ, you'll be entitled to rewards depending on how you lived your life. You don't get there by living your life a certain way. You get there by trusting Jesus Christ. But if you're there, there's obviously a difference. Now, there are people whose lives are a shambles. There'll be nothing that survives, but they themselves are still saved. Why? Because Jesus saved them. They didn't. We need to understand rewards. There's just as different degrees of punishment in Hades or hell, there's also different degrees of entitlement, if you will, in heaven. But the way you get, what determines which place you go is your position with Jesus Christ. Now, we've talked about timelines. One last one, we'll call it an evening. We have, in the past, is behind us. The future is ahead of us. We are now. The past is but a memory, the future but a hope. The question I want to ask you is, where is your connection to eternity? Most of us think of that as being yet future. The ultimate, you know, eternity is after death and so forth. No, no. Your eternity, your connection with eternity is right now. You are right now either destined for eternity in heaven or eternity in hell, depending on your position with respect to the person of Jesus Christ. And you're heading for a foreign country, and the only place they issue visas is on this side of the border. Your personal, your position in Christ. So why are we doing this presentation now? Because your eternity is only a heartbeat away. It can be a plane crash, a car crash, it can be a stray bullet, it can be an unexpected stroke. How many of you in the audience have had someone in your immediate surroundings, family or friends, suddenly die unexpectedly in the last year or so? Look at that, see, more than half the hands. You, too, have an appointment. And there are no accidents in God's kingdom. And by the way, there's great comfort in that. If you, so many people should get rid of this, if only this, or if only I had driven, or if only we'd taken a different road, or if only we'd taken a different plane, or if only, if no. That's false guilt. There are no accidents in God's kingdom. God, we may not understand it, but God has his purpose. And there will be a calling. And the question I want you to think about is, where will you find yourself when death calls? Will you be greeted at the portal by the Lord Jesus Christ as one of his, as an old friend of yours, someone that you've communicated with, someone that you've trusted and relied on? Or are you a stranger? Or will you be in the predicament of that rich man that we talked about in Luke 16? Do you know that rich man is a real man? And he's still waiting for the touch of a finger to cool his tongue? And how sure are you of where you're going? There's no reason to have any doubt at all. No doubt at all. What is the basis of your conviction as to where you're going? I want to remind you, Matthew 7, 21, 22, not everyone that saith to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Heavy words. I think there are going to be many people who think they're going to heaven that haven't done their homework and are going to suffer as a result. Difficult topic. I hope this acts as a springboard, if nothing else, for you to do your homework and re-examine the conditions and the presuppositions that you're making regarding your eternal destiny. In God's name, let's bow our hearts for a word of prayer. Father, we just praise you that there are no accidents in your kingdom, that everyone listening to these words is there by your divine appointment. We do pray, Father, you'd give them no peace until they rest in you, that they discover the person of Jesus Christ and the extremes, Father, that you've gone to, that we might spend an eternity in your presence as we commit ourselves into your hands without any reservation. In the name of Yeshua, our Lord and Savior, that righteous judge. Amen.